Hello everyone, and welcome back to World of Warships Blitz with Terry. Today we are looking at a Tier 7 premium British battleship. And this is HMS Rodney. It's not the Nelson, it's the Rodney. But you might ask Terry, why are we looking at, or why are we even having another Nelson class battleship in here? I mean, we already have the Nelson, and it looks exactly the same. Well, I'm glad that you ask. First of all, however, the Rodney, obviously a very, very famous ship because she was one of two Nelson-class battleships that was built after the Washington Naval Treaty towards treaty conditions. Unlike her sister, the Nelson, she was actually, the British were trying their best to stay within treaty limits, and that meant a lot of compromises to manage the 35,000 tons of displacement. And that's not what she's famous for, however. She is famous for sinking the Bismarck. Well, not on her own, but participating in the sinking of the Bismarck. By the time Rodney and the King George V had actually caught up to Bismarck, Bismarck was sailing around in circles merrily because she had taken an airdrop torpedo to the rudder from a couple of swordfish, and wasn't particularly combat effective, but they still gave battle, and after knocking out all Bismarck's turrets and shredding her superstructure, Rodney basically closed into point-blank range and actually torpedoed Bismarck. And I think I've seen different sources claiming that either all of the torpedoes did not detonate, or that one was a dud and one managed to go up. In the end, Bismarck wasn't sunk by Rodney's torpedoes, but she still remains, if true or not, one of the, if not the only battleship in history that has managed to torpedo another battleship. Now, if she's been successful in terms of detonation is a different question, but at least she's launched them at the Bismarck, and has fired her main guns at Bismarck at such close range that they had depressed so low that the amount of damage that Rodney's main guns were doing to herself was actually more than what the Bismarck had managed to inflict on her during the gun duel. So after that, Rodney, which already had a huge amount of problems because she was relatively lightly constructed compared to Nelson, who had seen a couple more refits, ended up becoming a bit of more of a liability and was sort of worn out towards the end of the war, and was then, after the war, promptly scrapped because the British did not want to renovate or refurbish the battleship any further. So, in game, we have Rodney and we have Nelson. And yes, they look absolutely the same. And that is correct because these are sister ships. And honestly, I much prefer seeing an existing sister ship in the game rather than, I don't know, a black variant or the 1942 variant or something like that. You know what I mean? But how do the two of them differ? Let's have a quick look. The first thing that we'll notice is that Rodney gets ship skills, which Nelson does not. Nelson is one of the very few Tier 7 ships, if might be even the only Tier 7 ship, that does not get any ship skills. Nelson did have the auto secondaries, but Rodney actually gets two precise aim. And these are precise aim 1, so they're not great, but you get two of them, which is two more than what the Nelson gets. Rodney also gets the British Battlecruiser Super Heal. This is the print yourself a new ship heal, but in return you only get two repair kits. But that can sort of heal back half of your hit points, so be sure not to use that too early. In terms of statistics, the hull is obviously the same. The Rodney is very, very marginally more maneuverable, but I would argue that in practice it doesn't make any difference. The guns is where it gets really interesting, because the Rodney's guns are armor-piercing focused. She gets very, very good AP shells, but she does not get the same ridiculous HE shells that you get on the Nelson. So effectively, Rodney is an AP Nelson. She's following the British battlecruiser line a lot more than the traditional battleship line, which is where kind of Nelson is situated. So that is the main difference between the two of them. And the guns in return get a 1.5 second longer base reload, but a slightly longer range as well. Both Nelson and Rodney actually have a pretty frightening array of secondaries. Now, they don't have the range on it, but they get six twin turrets of 150mm secondaries, and that can be quite intimidating for destroyers and similar. Although Rodney does not get the same hilarious destroyer blupping power that Nelson gets with her HE, because the HE does noticeably less damage on Rodney, but still a dangerous ship due to the gun layout. Then we've got the same set of auto secondaries, which you very rarely use, and the same absence of any AA. In terms of concealment, Rodney is ever so slightly worse, and maybe that is due to that obscure little thing on the, and I think the official terminology is X-turret, despite it being in front of the superstructure. So the third turret, you see it on top of it there, right? That, and I actually had to look that up because I had no idea what that was, that is a catapult for a supermarine walrus that was later installed on the Rodney. Nelson doesn't get that. But you can see that she gets the same turret arrangement, so you have the same setup like on the Nelson, where the X turret is swinging below the B turret, so it does not have to go the long way around. And you have the super firing 150s, which mean that if you're pointing the ship forward, you actually get a fair amount of firepower on target also with the secondaries. All right then, how can you set the ship up? You get the choice between reload, traverse, or main battery firing range. Now, precise the Rodney isn't. I personally prefer the reload, and I've gone for a complete reload build with this, because we do have the precise aim skill, we only get two charges of it. It's only a precise aim one, and there's another little snag in the captain build. So that's something we get to later. You could take the range if you wanted to. Personally, I prefer the reload and the traverse here for just throwing more shells downrange. You have a bit of a choice in the first slot. You could say go main battery mod 1. That'd be valid, I guess, to get the turrets faster, swung around faster, if you are bow in and generally trying to, you know, avoid incoming fire. Personally, I've gone for main battery mod 2 for a reload build here. You could also take secondary battery mod 1 to get the reload on the 150s down, especially thinking that, you know, if you're faced with destroyers more, these are actually quite capable. So there's a fair amount of things that you can do here. You could even go with the auxiliary armament modification to get a bit more range onto the 150s, because they have a 5.4km base range, which is not that long. Second slot, propulsion makes most sense, and steering in 3, although you may be able to take concealment if you want to. Personally, I again don't think it's a massive bonus, because I do tend to fire my guns, and it might make some sense depending on your playstyle. But that's how I've set her up. And as usual, we're playing two battles. In the first battle, I will be playing with the regular camo and the regular captain. And in the second one, we're playing with the historical camouflage, which looks interesting, very wavy pattern. I haven't checked if this is actually historically accurate, but this gives us hit points, range, dispersion, and as usual, the useless torpedo damage reduction. You can also put the industrial camo on, which looks almost good except for that big steampunk light at the bow. It does the exact same thing, so this is purely down to either what you can get your hands on or what you're into in terms of aesthetics. Commander skills, and here's where it gets a little interesting. So the one thing where it gets tricky is the level 5 skill, because you could get another precise aim, which you would normally want, because 2 is not an awful lot. 3 is definitely a good value. 4 is probably something I'd prefer in the end, especially with the marksman skill. But you would forego the survivalist skill, which gives you 15% HP recovery with the repair kits. And this thing has only two repair kits, but she gets the super heal. So going for an HP tank build on something as relatively poorly armored as a Nelson class battleship is not a terrible idea. However, that means you only get two precise aim. So that's a bit of a choice for you to make. Other than that, I have actually used John Tovey, the epic commander, rather than a legendary commander on the ship, because he is relatively unique in the British set in that he gets the armor-piercing cap shell plus. Although I have to say that the guns on the Rodney are quite fun as they stand, so if you wanted to go with, I think it was Nelson? Yeah, Nelson gives you the survivalist plus, so that would also be would have been an option. But then definitely don't go for the IFHE plus, go for the APCS, because Rodney is an armor-piercing ship, definitely. But you could go for the 22.5% HP. That would also be a good choice. Just in that case, you would be taking Marksman. So I have ended up with Tovey, and that's the setup for that. In the first game, as usual, with regular consumables and with only a level 7 commander. But for the second round, we're doing this one. All right, I think I've been talking enough about the ship now. Let's go and play some games in the Rodney. The first round we'll be playing is base capture on encounter, everybody's favorite. And we are facing a Pobeda, Monarch, Amagi, Nagato, an Omono, Kagero, and an Akatsuki. On encounter, more often than not these days, I actually see base trades. So keeping a little bit of an eye on the other flank is then generally a good idea. So you see there, I am spawning on the eastern side, which means there's going to be a triplet of enemy ships spawning on the western end. And currently where I'm standing, I don't actually have any flanking shots on this guy. So I'm going to move a little bit more into the middle to make sure that I can use my range where necessary. And obviously I don't necessarily want to deal with a carrier, but sticking with friendly ships is probably the best thing I can do in that regard. Anyway, I'll be heading over towards that island there, rather than just running down the flank here blindly. And we'll see what we encounter. There may be a destroyer coming down this way. There is the Kagero. I guess we'll get some early shots off and see what if we can get a lucky hit in. And the answer is no. He's moved in the meantime, so that's fine. Just didn't have anything better to shoot at. But now we do. There is the Omono, a light cruiser. And against light cruisers, yeah, that's what we're here for. So where are you going? Ah, he goes undetected. Precise aim, shots out at the last spotted location. And we've got a couple of hits in. Can still shoot at the Monarch, so it's not a complete waste, but it looks like my team has more or less abandoned our left flank, which is not uncommon. You see that a fair bit. So I'm probably in a decent position here. I don't know where our destroyer is going, but we'll find out eventually while we are shooting at the Omono. And that Amagi is very, very aggressive and has now found out that Omono has torpedoes. But the Omono itself is an open water gunboating, and that's generally not a great idea. It goes defensive against Amagi, which means he's giving full broadside to me, which means he's now a very dead Omono. And I think that Gneisenau on our left flank has been conducting a fighting retreat under air attack. So yeah, I'm going to come over and help out. And I'm not sure if the Kutuzov in the middle there has got a similar idea. Destroyer has changed flanks, is now running that flank probably for a cup. Would have been very useful against these two battleships over there, but you know, who am I to tell people how to play their rounds? I am going to get over there, however, and see if I can make myself useful. The friendly Shokaku appears to have gone AFK, has sent out planes early, but I'm not sure if they've done anything with them. And the Gneisenau is obviously on very low hit points and now running, but seeing a carrier means that these battleships, we've got an Amagi over there, these battleships are otherwise occupied, rather than trying to finish off that low health Gneisenau, and the Shokaku is dead. So now they have no more excuses, and the Gneisenau is on very low hit points. So I'm running in. I don't have an awful lot of armor, but I definitely have the heals ready in case I need them. And I do have some fire support from, I believe, the Kutuzov over here. Now we have the carrier coming in as well. There's still two enemy destroyers that we haven't spotted the whole battle, so I have no idea where those are. But the Yamagi, I think the Gneisenau is about to die. Yep, there she goes. Oop, oh no, Akatsuki. Slow down, slow down. The carrier has has timed the second torpedo drop pretty well. Don't want to use the heal yet, because we're too... it's a super heal, but I do want to switch over to the high explosive, because obviously the armor piercing is just over-penetrating. In a Nelson, that thing would have been dead. Where are these torpedoes aimed? I don't think they're aimed at me, actually. So Akatsuki's done an almost perfect stealth run up towards me, but then dropped the torpedoes elsewhere. Or maybe he was trying to hit me, I don't know. Anyway, back to the armor piercing, because I think that's an Amalfi problem. Never mind, Kutuzov has taken him out. And that leaves that lonely Nagato over there. We are one kill ahead now at this point, and we have held. Unfortunately, the cruisers have reacted, and it looks like the friendly destroyer has made its way over into the enemy capture circle, which does put some pressure onto them, because that means that the flank rush here has been defeated, and we are making our way over there. I've triggered my first heal, and you see I'm pretty much back to almost full hit points. So you can literally have a new ship ready pretty much with that heal when you're down to half health. And the guns are very nice. The armor piercing is very good. The Monarch has reacted and is going back. I'm not sure if the carriers... the enemy carrier is still around. I don't know where, but carrier is not in the capture circle. I think behind one of the islands there, which is wise, but seems to have trouble... Oh, and I think we found out where the cargo is having trouble to do something about the Akatsuki, who's about to... Was it an Akatsuki? I'm not sure. Who's just capped out, and that's already the end of the game. Quick round, but it goes to show that in a ship like the Rodney, you have to position yourself correctly to make sure... Because you're not very fast, to make sure that you can... get range and angles at things where needed, and for that you are very well positioned. And yes, the armor piercing on this is working very well. It was a Tashkent who's done nothing except sneaking over there and cupping, and the Shokako has been AFK on our side. Which brings us to the second round. This one with a fully upgraded captain. So this is the APCS Plus, and with a premium heal. That's kind of an important factor for this ship. Once again, it's a tier 8 game. Once again, we're bottom tier. Domination on Friar's Lantern. Nice map. I like that map. And especially domination mode. And we are facing Shokaku, Amagi, Colorado, Black Taco, not Black Taco, another Omono, and another Kagero. Lots of Japanese torpedoes there. both from the air and from the surface. But we're spawning up over in A-Cup, so I can definitely make my way over there. And in a carrier battle like this, given that the AA on the Nelson-class ships is pretty dreadful, it's generally a good idea to stick with something that has decent AA, like that Deceiven Provincian over there. That thing has, from memory, relatively good AA, plus the level bombers that you can call in. The friendly carrier is changing position, has not brought any planes out to scout, and the enemy carrier is just fighter scouting at this point, but hasn't actually brought anything out yet in order to drop it on anybody. So right now we're relatively unhampered. We should be spotted here in a second, once the fighters... fighter's not close enough yet for air spot, maybe not. But he definitely knows that the Zeven Provincian is there. Given that the friendly carrier makes no efforts in spotting, the DZP does it himself, sacrifices one of his strike wings because he can't target it. But he's used it to find out what's over there. And there is one of the Takaos, So there are going to be torpedoes, and we're definitely rushing with a in a Nelson-class battleship that is more of a pedestrian stroll, but still making our way towards the capture circle to give fire support. Obviously, we do have to be a little careful about the incoming torpedoes, more so about the incoming airstrike, which is aimed at me, but with a DZP parked right next to me, and there come the Takao torpedoes. I think we haven't actually really taken any damage. See, this is how you generally deal with things. If you are in a these are Takao torpedoes. If you are in a poor AA ship, you do your best to park yourself next to something that does actually have AA and use that. That's what AA bubbles are for. Anyway, DZP is very aggressive here. Goes for the cap, which is great. Now that the incoming Takao torpedoes have run their course and that the carrier strike has been defeated, I'm on my way back in as well. I think the Colorado next to me is not interested. Carrier goes for the Seven Provincian. And obviously the Takaos themselves are launching attacks as well there. So DZP has lost about half his hit points and needs to back out, and that's fine. Okay, Colorado is moving in as well. Well done, Colorado. So now it's the battleship's turns to make their way in, to take some fire and to do some tanking. Still not triggering the heal, because I'm not yet down to below half health. So don't you have to fight your instincts a little bit here. Don't trigger too early. Okay, Colorado can take some hits. I'll deal with the Takao, who has gone AFK by the looks of it, or has just rapidly stopped. I'm seeing this a fair bit these days, that ships players just go AFK. I don't know if it's a general connection issue or if they're just like, yeah, I know what, I don't want to play anymore, but that Takao should be dead. There he goes. And we actually have range on the enemy Shokaku, which is nice. There's also a Colorado, and now Colorado and myself are shielding the DZP from further damage, while we can use his AA to create an anti-air bubble around ourselves, which is good. There's Amagi, enemy Colorado, and the carrier coming in, so that's probably about as far forward as I want to go. There's still the other Takao over there, so we can finish that one up. Still not really triggering the heal. I think I can still go down a little bit further. Let's see if we can finish off the Takao, who still sails broadside, thinking that he is safe. He is not. And oh, come on. Oh well, Shores takes him out. Okay, now I can trigger a heal. That's about the right time. And you see, there we go. Ship's coming back. DZP shoots down all the planes. Colorado is in secondary range, actually, and friendly Shores ducks behind cover as well. So again, I'm in the battleship. I'm a move forward, finish off the Colorado. Shokaku is about to die. So it's just Kagro. Yep, there she goes. So it's just Kagro and that lonely Amagi over there. DZP's lost a lot of hit points, but has played very well. Thanks for the air cover, for the scout, and for the aggressive playstyle, rather than sitting behind an island and just farming damage. That's always much appreciated if players do that. And there is a Ruffle Stomp medal up for grabs here, if we can manage to not die. So I've got the hit points. I've got another heal to spare, so I still can tank a lot. I could still tank a lot more if I needed to. So let's move forward towards that Amagi. I think that was a little too high. Yeah, that just hit the superstructure. That should have been a little lower, because I think Amagi is actually turning in at this point. He is still getting blonked by the Seven Provincian. But it's now shooting at me instead of trying to finish off the cruiser. But we have lost one of our cruisers, so sadly no Ruffle Stomp, but that's okay. Let's finish off the Amagi. And I just turned out, double Citadel, just turned out I would have finished him off if I had the third turret on target there with manual aim. Now that's the power of these guns, especially at close to mid-range. They are very, very powerful, and well done, DZP. Yes, it is a bit of an overpowered ship, but well played. Can't complain about good team play there in that cruiser and defeating airstrikes. But it gives you a bit of a taste of what you can get done in the Rodney. Even if you're bottom tier, it is a very, very good ship. And I would say, in the end, if you already have a Nelson and you always wanted an AP Nelson, that's the ship for you. If you don't have a Nelson and you always wanted one, this is a ship that you could get, or you could save up the free XP to get the Nelson herself, which is more of an HE-focused ship. It's also a good ship. And maybe you really enjoy the Nelson so much that you want two of them, and that's also fine. But generally, I can recommend the ship is a good one. Depending on how she comes out, I have no idea, I haven't paid attention, then it's a ship for a tier 7 battleship. It's a good choice. And that's it for me today. Thanks, everybody. And I will see you next time. Bye-bye.